no good deed. It's cold, well below freezing, and the wind whipping off the East River doesn't help. To make matters worse, you're not dressed properly. Layers is what they keep telling you on those TV news stories about how to beat the cold now that winter has arrived. And wear a hat. Oh yes, a hat is essential in freezing weather, because it keeps the heat in, as if we're human thermoses. To make matters worse, that it's going to snow any minute feel is in the air. None of this bodes well for what you're about to get yourself into. You have to run out real quick, so you pull on a sweater. It's cotton, not wool, which claws at your skin like some medieval torture method. Grab your black leather bomber jacket and head out the door. You don't even remember to wrap a scarf around your neck. As for gloves, well, you know you have a pair somewhere, but you don't have time to look for them. It's dark out, closing in on 10 p.m. No one but a complete idiot would be out on the streets this time of night in this kind of weather. Even those Upper East Siders with dogs are smart enough to hire a walker. There's no reason to be out on a night like this unless you're doing a favor for someone. A big favor. A favor you don't even owe that person. Just a favor you're doing because it's for a friend and because you're not secure enough about your own worth that you dare say, "I'm sorry, but I just can't do it." Maybe another time, not tonight. Or maybe it's because you didn't think fast enough to say no, because your brain was dulled from having too much to drink after a fight with your girlfriend. So you say yes, even though you want to say no. The favor doesn't seem that complicated. He doesn't even ease into it by saying, "Sorry for calling so late," or asking, "Have you been?" He doesn't do any of that. He just wants a favor. A small favor, he says. All you have to do is hand over an envelope to some guy you've never seen before, in a spot you've never been to. "What's all this about?" you ask when your friend reveals what he wants. "I can't really say," says your friend. His name is Ralph, and let's face it, he's not even a real friend. He's someone you worked with for a year or so. You see him at work, an occasional group drink after work, and you even went to a ball game with him once when he had an extra ticket, knowing you probably weren't first on his invite list. What makes it even crazier is you haven't worked with him for several weeks because he got canned, not excessed, not superannuated, fired. Security escorted him out, that kind of fired. He's stolen money from the firm, but that's not something you can ask him about, and it's not something the firm would want to publicize. You know it because it's your job to know such things. "What's in the envelope?" you ask when he explains what the favor is. He hesitates a moment, then says, "Money." "You want me to deliver money to someone?" "Yeah." "Why?" "Because I owe it." "Gambling debt?" "I don't gamble anymore, remember?" You don't know him as well as he thinks you do, so the answer is, no, you don't remember. Only you don't say that. What would be the point? Then what's it for? The less you know, the better. For who? For you. "Listen, Ralph, this has a bad feel to it. It sounds like it's something that might be dangerous. You think I'd get you involved if it was dangerous?" "I don't know. Would you?" "No, of course not." "Then why can't you do it yourself?" "It's complicated," he says. You're pissed, and you say, "I've got a college education. I've dealt with complicated concepts before." "Look," he goes, "I got myself into a little trouble. Nothing really bad, but the only way I can get out of it is to pay someone off." "What kind of trouble?" "I can't say. I really need you to do this for me. I can pay you." "Forget it. I'm not taking your money. But speaking of paying someone, why not do that? Why not hire a messenger? Why ask me?" "Because I trust you." You don't want this to go on all night, especially since in the end, you know you're going to do it. So because it's getting late and all you want to do is go to bed, you agree. "Hey man, that's great. I really owe you one." "No, really, I owe you one. You're really bailing me out of a tough spot." You're impressed. You don't want or need him to owe you one. You don't even know what that one would be, or even if you had one, why you'd ask him. "I'll leave the envelope for you with your doorman in 10 minutes, okay?" "You're that close?" "Yeah, just a few blocks away." "You knew I'd say yes, didn't you?" "Yeah, I knew you wouldn't let me down. I know you're a stand-up guy. 10 minutes, okay?" "Buzz and I'll come down and get it." "No, I'm just going to leave it with your doorman, and then I got to be somewhere." That should set off alarm bells, but it doesn't. Maybe because it's late and all you can think about is what a jerk you are to do this for a guy who isn't even a friend, a guy you've known less than a year. So that's why you've got this thick envelope in your pocket, and you're headed east, crossing York Avenue at 62nd Street, headed over toward the East River. The wind has picked up considerably, and the closer to the river you get, the stronger it is. A couple gusts almost knock you over, and you're not a little guy. You used to be 6 feet, but the last time you went to the doctor, he insisted you were 5'11". You tried to argue that wasn't right, but he was adamant. "We all shrink as we age," he explained. "I'm not that old," you said. "You're pushing 50," he said. "And that's supposed to be old?" He didn't say anything. He just smiled. You pass the playground, empty now because who in his right mind would be out, headed toward the river on a night like this? You're supposed to get on the East River Walk and head south. Once you get near the 59th Street Bridge, you're supposed to find a bench and sit there until someone comes by and says, "Pretty shitty night to be out here, isn't it?" Like you're in the middle of some John le Carré novel, when all you really want is to get out of the cold. You're supposed to answer, "It sure is." When you ask your friend how long you're supposed to wait, he tells you, "Not long, 10 minutes tops. He might even be there by the time you get there." You don't know what's going on, but of one thing you're sure, it's a pretty shitty night to be out there. And now it's getting worse, because you can feel an occasional snowflake brushing up against your face. You can see the bridge ahead, looming above you, making you feel small and insignificant. There seems to be someone sitting there on a bench. Is it your guy? You'll only know if he asks about the weather. A rat scurries right in front of you, close enough so it brushes against your front foot. It's headed west toward shelter, or maybe toward an overflowing trash can. You shudder. Not so much from the cold, but from the idea that a rat has come that close to you. There are probably others. You can't wait to get this over with. You pat your jacket at the left breast, the spot where you've got the envelope, just to make sure it's there. You're curious as to how much is in there, but you're afraid if you open it, a stiff wind will come and blow the bills into the East River. You look to your left at the river, which reflects the lights of buildings along the FDR Drive. The only boat you see is maybe a half a mile to a mile away, a tanker heading north. On the other side of the river is Roosevelt Island. You look up to see a tram coming back to Manhattan, swaying from the wind. You're thankful you're not in it, and you wonder if the strong winds will shut it down for the night. And if it is, will everyone on the island be stranded there, maybe forever, or at least until the wind dies down? You're about 30, 40 yards from the bench. The figure that sits there isn't moving. A frightening thought crosses your mind. Is he alive? Am I being set up? Not possible, you think. You've watched too many crime movies and TV shows. The real world isn't like that. Dead bodies don't just appear in front of you, even if it is a dark and stormy night. Your imagination is just running wild. You start walking again. As you get closer, you see it's not a dead body. It's just someone sitting very still, huddled against the cold, waiting for you to say the sentence that means you should hand over the envelope filled with cash. It's almost over, but you can't help your mind going somewhere else, somewhere it has no business going. What is this money for? If it's not to pay off a gambling debt, what will it pay for? Are you being used as a patsy to deliver money to a hitman? Will you be implicated in a murder? An accessory before the fact? Of course, it could be something very innocent, money to help a friend. But wait, Ralph was fired for stealing money, right? What if this is a payoff to someone to keep their mouth shut? Or money to be split with a partner in crime? Maybe that's why he's chosen you, because you know what happened at work, but he doesn't know what you know. He couldn't possibly. But what better place to commit a murder than only a few feet from a fast-moving river? A knife in your ribs, a bullet straight through the heart, a blackjack to the side of your head, just hard enough to render you unconscious. No threat to fight for you. And then, dead or alive, over the railing and into the freezing river. A river that changes direction 4 times a day. North, then south, then north, then south again. South toward Brooklyn, then north toward the Bronx. You learn in school that although it's called the East River, it's not really a river at all. It's a saltwater tidal estuary. You don't even know what that means, But will that be your final resting place? Will you be doomed to travel north, then south, then north, then south, never actually reaching a destination? And if your body is eventually spotted, then scooped out of the brackish water, will you be recognizable? Will you have to be buried in Potter's Field, just another anonymous stiff plucked out of the river? Will your relatives and friends spend the rest of their lives wondering what happened to you? Will you leave this mortal coil, not with a bang, but a whimper? These are the thoughts that careen through your mind, your fertile imagination stoked by the ever-worsening weather, and the cold wind that stings your face and brings tears to your eyes, not from grief, but from brutal elements. Whatever it is you're involved in, it can't be innocent, or why else would you be asked to deliver the money in the middle of a wintry night in a spot so desolate that there are only two human beings and rats scurrying around, scrounging for food? Now, all you want is to hand over the envelope and get the hell out of there, before you become part of a story splashed all over the front page of the New York Post. But you've come this far, so you need to finish the job. Not so much because you promised, but because you need to know the ending. You need to know if you're going to be part of a crime or just another sucker doing a favor for someone you hardly know. And when you get right down to it, you don't even like. The only way to find out is to continue toward the bench and have a conversation about the shitty weather. When you reach the bench, the figure, dressed in a heavy overcoat, a thick scarf wrapped around his neck and chin, a watch cap pulled down so that all you can see are his eyes and nose, looks up. His hands are shoved deep into his pockets. "Pretty shitty night to be out here, isn't it?" he asks, in a raspy voice that slices through the wind. "Yes," you say, "it is." "This is it. This is the guy." You reach into your jacket and pull out the envelope. "I'm supposed to give you this," you say. "I know," he says, as he takes one of his hands out of his pocket. You see he was smart enough to wear gloves. He takes the envelope from you with his left hand and puts it in his coat pocket. It's over. You can leave now. You've done your favor. You start to turn, but before you do, you see, out of the corner of your eye, his right hand come out of his other pocket. It's holding something. You can't quite make it out. Is it a phone? Will he be calling your friend to tell him the favor has been done? You see a bright flash coming from the object. At the same time, you hear, above the sound of the wind whipping in from the river, a loud noise. It's a familiar sound, a bang, the kind you hear on TV if you're watching Law and Order. You feel something slam against your chest, and the last thing you think, before you hit the ground, is, "I wonder which way the river is flowing. Where will I wind up? Will it be the Bronx or will it be Brooklyn?"